Here's the last one. Where should we put it?
Here, let me put it on.
Mommy, don't forget baby Jesus.
That's a good boy. Christmas wouldn't be Christmas without baby Jesus. You want some attention too, don't you, baby?
Mommy?
Yes, dear?
Tell us the story of the brightest night.
Tell the story, Mommy.
The story about baby Jesus, like you do every Christmas.
All right. You set up the manger, and I'll tell the story. Many, many years ago, there lived in the town of Nazareth a kind young lady whose name was Mary. One day, while Mary was busy in her home, she suddenly saw a bright light. And in this light, there stood an angel who said, "Mary, don't be afraid. I'm Gabriel. God sent me to tell you that he has chosen you to be the mother of his son. Call him Jesus, for he will be God's son and the savior of all people." Mary said, "I don't know how all this can be." The angel said, "Mary, God can do everything." Then Mary said, "If this is what God wants, I'll be glad to do his will." The angel of the Lord then went to Joseph, who was engaged to Mary. And the angel said, "Joseph, take Mary to be your wife. God wants her to be the mother of baby Jesus. And you shall be his father here on earth and take care of him." And Joseph did as the angel told him. While all of this was happening in Nazareth, Caesar Augustus was king in the big city of Rome, many hundreds of miles away. One day, Caesar Augustus made a law that everybody in his kingdom was to be counted. All of the people had to go back to the place where they had been born. Mary and Joseph heard about this new law. They got ready for the trip to Bethlehem, where they both had been born. Mary and Joseph had only a few things to pack, since they were poor people. All Joseph had was a little donkey. Joseph walked, leading the donkey, while Mary rode on the donkey with a small bundle of baggage. Hour after hour, mile after mile, day after day, they walked and walked in the cold wind. Joseph took very good care of Mary. Many times he stopped along the road to rest and to give Mary a drink of fresh water. Finally, late one afternoon, they came to Bethlehem. When they got to the tax office, they had to wait for all the other people who had come ahead of them to be counted. When Mary and Joseph had finally finished, it was getting dark. Both were very tired. So was the little donkey. Joseph now had to look for a place to stay overnight. He first went to the little inn, the hotel in Bethlehem. But the man told him, "You're much too late. I have no room left." He didn't even say, "I'm sorry." So Mary and Joseph went from house to house. But everybody told them, "You're too late. No room. No room." God had not forgotten them. At the last place, the man saw how tired and worn out Mary was. She could hardly keep her eyes open. This man told Joseph, "I have an old stable where you may stay. I'm sorry, but that's the best I have left." So Joseph took Mary to the little stable. Here he made a nice bed for Mary with the hay and straw. And after Joseph had fed the little donkey, he also went to bed. In the fields outside Bethlehem that night, there were some lonely shepherds taking care of their sheep. It was quiet and dark and cold. Nothing could be heard but the crackling of the little fire which the shepherds had built to keep them warm. Then, all of a sudden, a bright light shone down on the shepherds. The shepherds were very much afraid. In this bright light, there was an angel who told the shepherds, "Don't be afraid. I have some good news for you. Jesus the Savior is born. You will find him wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And while this angel was still speaking, the blue sky opened up and many, many angels filled the sky. These angels sang the wonderful song, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." Oh, how happy the shepherds were. How they listened. Never before had they heard or seen anything like this. When their song was ended, the angels went back into heaven, and the blue sky closed up, and all was quiet and dark and cold as before. The shepherds were all excited about the good news. They said, "Let's go right now to see the baby Jesus." So the shepherds hurried to Bethlehem. In the stable, Mary and Joseph were very happy because that very same night, baby Jesus had been born. She had put baby Jesus in the manger where Joseph had made a soft bed for him with the hay and the straw. When the shepherds came to the stable, they found baby Jesus just as the angel said they would. The shepherds kneeled down and prayed to the baby Jesus because he was their Savior, just as he is our Savior. On their way back to their sheep, the shepherds told the people in Bethlehem about the wonderful things that they'd seen and heard. And we're like the shepherds, too. We tell others the good news about baby Jesus. Did you like the story?
But that isn't all, Mommy. You didn't tell the story about the wise men.
Well, how about letting Daddy tell that part?
Come on, Daddy.
Well, let's see. After the shepherds had found the baby Jesus, some wise men in a faraway land were studying the stars. One night they saw a bright star they had never seen before. This new star was so different from all the other stars. The wise men were certain that it was a special sign that Jesus, the King of the Jews, the promised Savior, had been born. As it sparkled in the sky, the new star seemed to say to the wise men, "Come, I will lead you to the baby Jesus." So the wise men got ready for the trip. They packed their clothes and some food. They also took along some very fine presents. After the wise men had given their camels a long drink, they started on their journey. On their way to find baby Jesus, the wise men had to cross small and big rivers. They had to go up and down hills and mountains. They had to cross miles of hot desert. But they kept on going. Finally, months after the first Christmas, the wise men came to the big city of Jerusalem, where the king lived. Here they asked the people, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? We have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." But no one seemed to know anything about this new king. Finally, a messenger told wicked King Herod about the wise men from the east and about the new king they were trying to find. When he heard this, Herod was afraid. He wanted to be king all by himself. He didn't want anyone else to be king. Wicked King Herod now called in the teachers from the temple. They looked into the Bible scrolls and found that many years earlier, one of God's prophets had said that the new king, baby Jesus, was to be born in Bethlehem. When Herod learned this, he called in the wise men and told them to go to Bethlehem and to let him know when they found the baby Jesus. Herod told the wise men that he wanted to worship baby Jesus too, but he was really making plans to kill him. The wise men were soon on their way to Bethlehem. When they got outside the city of Jerusalem, to their great surprise, they saw the same new star they had seen in the east. This new star was showing them the way to Bethlehem. So the wise men followed the star. And when they came to the house over which the star stopped, they got off their camels and knocked on the door. Inside the house, they found Mary, Joseph, and baby Jesus, who no longer was a tiny baby. The wise men fell upon their knees and worshipped him. They also gave baby Jesus the wonderful presents they had brought him all the way from the east. They gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh, all very expensive and precious gifts. That night, the wise men stayed in Bethlehem. While they were sleeping, an angel came to them in a dream and told them not to go back and tell wicked King Herod that they had found the baby Jesus. The angel told them that King Herod was planning to kill the baby Jesus. So the next morning, the wise men got on their camels and took a different road back to their own homes far away in the east. The wise men were like the shepherds. They were happy they had seen and worshipped the baby Jesus.
And we're happy with them too, aren't we? Christmas wouldn't be Christmas without the baby Jesus.
certainly created a great impression with your music, my dear Gruber. My congratulations. After this.
In the name of the Emperor, let it be known that under penalty of death, all men between 25 and 40 years of age who are able to bear arms must report to their hometowns within 24 hours.
That means all.
One uniform for another.
Ah, there's a pipe for Napoleon.
Come on.
All right. I'll buy my linen freedom from Napoleon. It only costs 200 guilders.
Yes, but what about that, Commander?
Do you have to go too?
Need no friend, the son's got to go.
Yeah,
no. They've kept him, the dogs. I forfeit your old liberty, and now my son must fight for Napoleon.
Mind what you're saying, Brenda.
Ah.
Very shame that our men should fight for us before.
Louis. In 3 days, you'll have to be ready to leave. You know what will happen otherwise.
All right. I'll be there.
What is it?
Brenda, give me your hand.
So, that's what you want. What was your father?
Did you hear me? You know that. Anyhow, he was an honest man.
But this honest man fought against his own people. And for whom?
For Napoleon. He was forced into the army, Brenda.
Forced? Listen to me. In memory of Tyrol's betrayed freedom, I swear that no son of a man who was a traitor to his own land shall ever marry into my family.
Is that fair, Father?
That's my final word.
Louis?
Thank you.
only had news.
Here we are.
Thanks for the lift.
Louis!
Louis!
Darling, is it really you?
Teddy.
I'm thankful to see you again.
Down now.
Who's
that?
Why,
it's
Louis.
Louis, no. Are you sure?
Yes, it's Louis. Give him something to drink. He looks all right. He looks like he's got fever.
Ask him about Leonard. Louis, do you know anything about Leonard? He died in my arms. Get a bed ready.
Oh, yes, sir. Father.
You stay here. See if you can behave yourselves.
We will. Yes, we will.
Good morning, Francis.
Welcome, Joseph. And nice of you to come as well.
Good morning.
Read this letter.
The magistrate has taken recognition and judgment in the matter of the petition laid before the town council by one Franz Gruber, schoolmaster.
That's you, Mr. Gruber.
Herewith is declared that to one Louis Taylor, Rathsman, is granted full citizenship in our honorable town with all the rights and duties pertaining thereto.
Well, that fixes everything.
Signed, Matthew Stoffel, Burgomaster. This will be good news for Louis, Francis.
Thank you. How do you do, Reverend?
I'm glad to see you, Mrs. Gruber.
Thank you. Anne, dear, now you are a happy girl, aren't you?
Yes, of course. I'm happy at the thought that now Father may change his mind about our marriage.
Brenda. Come along. Look here. Now, think it over. Louis is an honest, upstanding lad.
Father, I love him. He has my word. And I keep my word just like you.
Then get out. Be loyal to him. But then, you'll be no longer my daughter.
May you never regret those words, Father.
Brenda. Our Leonard is dead. And now you thrust Anne from you. Ah! Thick-headed crank! Anne.
My dear, what is it? What's happened?
Father won't hear of it.
You're of age? What do I care for my citizenship if I can't have you? Let's get married and come with me to my cottage in the mountains. Eh?
Yes. Let's not wait any longer.
Here you are.
I can't thank you enough, Bethlehem. Dear children, we'll think of you every day.
I'm sure that you both will be happy and hope that everything will turn out for the best.
I'm sure it will.
Help them, Gruber.
Our wedding anniversary, Anne. They have been happy years, darling. Well, young man, what do you want?
I'm awfully hungry, Daddy.
Well, we must have dinner right away. Like this weather.
he goes again. Can't seem to rest. Sounds like he was ghost hunting.
Take us in, Brenda. We've lost everything. Forget.
An oath is an oath.
You. And your grandchild? Oh, what's the use? Has more heart than your father.
What now?
Well, we'll have to try our friends.
Silent night, holy night. All is calm, all is bright. Round, beyond. Silent night, holy. Listen.
Anne has returned with her husband and child. They have no place to stay.
Yes.
Brandor has turned them from his door.
Terrible.
What? I saw them in the inn stable last night, and this lyric came to me. You must set it to music for the Christmas Mass tonight.
Silent night, holy night. All is calm, all is bright. Why, Joseph is lovely. I feel sure I can find a melody for it.
Christmas joy, Christmas peace, but there is also Christmas sin.
St. John says, he came unto his own, and they knew him not. And each one of you who shuts his door in a beggar's face shuts out the Lord. Who said, what ye do unto the least of mine, ye do unto me. Don't shut out the Lord when he knocks with a beggar's hand at your door. Commit not this Christmas sin, for then only have you truly goodwill. Then we have indeed Christmas peace. Amen.
on a hillside near Bethlehem, sat a very young shepherd, playing a gay, happy tune on his little wooden pipe. In that year, the Emperor of Rome had ordered all the people to be counted and taxed, each man in his own city. And so the highways were soon filled with travelers, returning to the towns where they had been born. On the road were a carpenter called Joseph and his wife, Mary. Their hometown, Bethlehem, was a city now filled with visitors, all looking for places to stay. And by twilight, Joseph and Mary were weary of searching. They had tried to find shelter for the night, and while people with plenty of money to offer were taken care of, Joseph and Mary were always turned away. Each place they stopped seemed to be full. Again and again they were disappointed and had to move on. When they came to the owner of one of the last inns, they were told that it too was full. But then the innkeeper remembered an old barn in back of his place of lodging. It was not much of a place, but Joseph and Mary were welcome to use it. This was where they would stay for the night. And in this old, dingy stable, the animals made room for the unexpected guests. As Joseph made Mary comfortable and the weary tourists took their rest, night settled over Bethlehem. And in the stillness of that holy night, the little town waited silently for the wondrous gift that was to be given. In the sky that night, in the sky above the sleeping city, a strange new star appeared. The Star of Bethlehem, telling of the birth of a great new king to be cradled in a manger. And so it was that Christ the Savior was born in Bethlehem on that silent night so long ago. Nearby in the countryside, the shepherds were watching by their fires. Then, with the star, appeared a light, bright with the glory of angels. Angels who sang to them of the birth of a king in a manger in Bethlehem. Wonder and surprise, the shepherds hoped to see the child of whom the angels sang. They gathered their sheep together and started toward the town. From the hilltop, they could see the star, and beneath it, they knew they would find the stable whose manger held the heavenly king. On they came, and the first to arrive was the very young shepherd, playing his pipe. As he saw the baby with Mary and Joseph, he came close to the manger. Before the holy child, the shepherds all knelt and offered to him the beloved pipe, a sheepskin cap, and a little lamb. And when they had worshipped him, they would go to tell others of this wonderful thing that had happened. Far to the east, there were others who saw the star. In Turkestan, a princely astronomer sat studying his instruments. And suddenly in the sky above, the new star shone. In India, a king watched from the balcony of his marble-columned palace as the star grew larger and larger. And on the desert sands of Arabia, a ruler was gazing toward the heavens, seeing that same star as it told of the new king's birth. To them all, it meant that a king had been sent from God, a king they would worship. Each one set out to follow the star and to bring to the child a gift of love. The astronomer boarded his ship. And sailed over the waves toward the guiding star. The Indian ruler, on an elephant, moved toward the mountains as the star went before him. And from Arabia, across the desert, came the third king on a camel. It was a long journey, and a hard one for all of them. But as they followed the star, each came nearer to the land of Israel, where Herod ruled. King Herod also saw the star and sent for his counselors. To Herod's advisors, the star fulfilled a prophecy that a king should be born in Bethlehem, in the land of Judah. And while the eastern kings continued their journey toward Jerusalem, Herod was disturbed by this unwelcome news. Thinking surely that King Herod could direct them to the newborn child, the wise men came to his palace to seek his advice. Perhaps they would find the babe there, in the palace. Herod sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "When you have found the child, tell me that I may worship him also." Of course, the wicked Herod had other plans, for he was jealous of the child king. But the wise men, who would be warned by God, were to return home another way. And so once more the kings from the east took their gifts and followed the guiding star. It led them out the north gates of the city, on toward the Bethlehem hills. Then, above the little town, it seemed to stop. At last they knew that here, in Bethlehem, they should find the newborn king. They did find him, and with him the young shepherd who had brought the first gift to the manger. They knew that the star had led them to this child who was the king they were seeking. The wise men went into the Holy Family and offered their gifts to the infant Jesus. Filled with awe and wonder, they knelt before him and put at his feet a crown of gold. A a chest of frankincense, a jar of myrrh. And they worshipped him, the child of the line of David, the Son of God, the King to be called Emmanuel.